الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. اللهم فرج عن المسلمين في كل مكان، اللهم فرج عن المسلمين في كل مكان، اللهم فرج عن المسلمين في كل مكان. Oh Allah, accept from us, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen, forgive us our sins and overlook our shortcomings. Grant us good in this life and the next life and protect us from the hellfire, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, give relief to our brothers and sisters who are suffering everywhere, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Wa salli lahum ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings, every Thursday night, and to be more correct Islamically, every Friday night, because this is the night of a Friday, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us in this masjid to have a dhikr session and an introduction before the dhikr session, inshallah, as usual. From among the ayat that have been recited, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullaha dhikran kathira. And the Muslim, whenever he or she recites the Quran, and you hear this call, you have to pay full attention. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. The creator of the heavens and the earth is calling you. Who are you and who am I? Who are you and who am I? And who are we to be called and to be addressed by the creator of the heavens and the earth? Is not that in itself a great honor, a great, 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 great honor for us to be addressed and to receive a message from the creator of the heavens and the earth, subhanahu wa ta'ala? So whenever he says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, you say, Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Yes, O Allah, I'm here and I'm ready to obey. Because when he's calling you, this means what? As the scholars say, after this sentence, after this call, there will be either a command or a prohibition, either amr or nahi. He will either tell you do this or he will tell you don't do this. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullaha dhikran kathira. O you who believe, you have believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a Lord, as a Rabb, as a creator, as a sustainer. Yes, Allah, what do you command us? اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا. Remember Allah abundantly. Abundantly. اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا. And this session is to respond to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we mentioned many times, there is nothing in the Quran that Allah commands you to do abundantly except for dhikr. He doesn't tell you pray a lot, nor fast a lot, nor go on hajj a lot. He doesn't tell you any of these in any ayah. But he tells you in at least five ayat, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu dhkuru allaha dhikran kathira. This is why Allah blessed us to learn from the shaykhs who paid attention to this very important act of worship, which is in reality the purpose of all of the other acts of worship. The purpose of all of the acts of worship is to attain dhikr of Allah. What's the proof? No Muslim on the face of the earth can say something in the religion without a proof from the Quran or the Sunnah of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or the consensus of the reliable scholars. What's the proof that the purpose of all of the ibadat is dhikr? Yes. Surah Taha, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ. Anyone knows the ayah? لِذِكْرِي. أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. Perform prayer so that you remember me. So that you remember me. Fasting, why is fasting? One of the main purposes of fasting is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to train me and you to have His dhikr, to remember Him, that He's watching us. He's watching you. Wherever you are, He's watching you. So you don't go and break your fast. If you're by yourself at home, you don't go like when we were young, we go to the kitchen and we just eat something, then we come back and mashallah, as if we're fasting. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is training you that you have to know He's with you everywhere by His knowledge subhanahu wa ta'ala watching you. Hajj. لِيَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَةٍ. Hajj is so that they remember Allah. Jum'ah prayer. فَإِذَا قَضَيْتُمْ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمُعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Remember Allah. After Salat al-Jum'ah, فَإِذَا قُضِيَتِ الصَّلَاةُ فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. On the other hand, some of the attributes of the munafiqeen, the hypocrites, is وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. They remember Allah, but little. This is Quran, this is all Quran. Something got my attention in these ayat after subhanahu wa ta'ala, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us, O you who believe, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, dhkuru Allah dhikran kathira wasabbihuhu bukratan wa asila, morning and evening. Then after two ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ya ayyuhan nabiyyu inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashshiran wa nadhiran wa da'iyan ila Allah. He mentions subhanahu wa ta'ala that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a bearer of the glad tidings, and a warner, and a da'i, da'iyan ila Allah, caller to Allah, someone who invites others to Allah, bi'idhnihi, by his permission, and by his leave, wa da'iyan ila Allah bi'idhnihi, what else? Wa sirajan munira, an illuminating lamp, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do you become an illuminating lamp? By the previous command, dhikr. You see the connection? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمُنُوا اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا وَسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. After two ayat, he tells our beloved صلى الله عليه وسلم وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ, your caller to Allah by his permission, and you're an illuminating lamp. How can you be an illuminating lamp without dhikr? Dhikr will make you an illuminating lamp. This lesson is absolutely for myself, before anyone else. How can we, dear brothers and sisters, inshallah, I'm going to finish with this. This is the inshallah, the summary of this short reminder. How did Islam enter Pakistan and India and Indonesia and Malaysia? Anyone from that country knows? How? How did Islam reach you guys? Huh? What army reached there? Huh? Sufi. Astaghfirullah, what Sufi is here? Sufis mean deviant people. Sufi, right? No army reached Pakistan or India or Indonesia or Malaysia, right? Go and read history books and learn and see how Islam spread in those countries and many other countries. How? No armies reached there. But there were the armies of those teachers who had dhikr of Allah, and by the dhikr of Allah they turned into illuminating lamps through which they attracted the residents of those people who accepted Islam. So it is, yes, it is the Sufi people, it is the great people who adhere to this tarbiyah, to this spiritual education, to this dhikr. Yes, because the Sufi and the Tasawwuf people are the ones who focus on dhikr and are the ones who have these dhikr sessions and salah ala nabi sessions regularly. Sufi ones are the ones who hold their subha and they do 100 times salah ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, least 1,000 times salah ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 100 times la ilaha illallah, 100 times subhanallah. These are the ones, through dhikr of Allah, they acquired these lights through which they attracted people of those countries. And the people of those countries, they know them very well. They know how Islam was spread. Now in this country, and regardless of the name, we are Muslims, alhamdulillah. And Since someone said Sufis, astaghfirullah, why you bothered? Good that you spoke. Good that you spoke. You know why? Because unfortunately now many Muslims, they think that Sufis are like, these are deviant people. These are like, someone came to me after one of the khutbas, he said, like these people, they have secret rituals and they have hidden religion. And I said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. The greatest scholars of Islam, they are Sufi scholars. The greatest imams of Islam, they are Sufi imams. And what does that mean? This means they take care of the soul purification and they focus on dhikr of Allah and they focus on drawing you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the Quran and Sunnah. Anything that contradicts Quran and Sunnah, we throw it away. That's what tasawwuf is. It's not Sufism. We reject this name. There's nothing called Sufism. Tasawwuf is a science of the sciences of Islam. It's not a sect, it's not a group, it's not a religion. We have to be very careful, dear brothers and sisters. And if we criticize people, we have to be aware. Because if you criticize Sufis, you're criticizing the major scholars of the Ummah, the scholars who transmitted the Quran to us. You will not find a single chain of the people who transmitted the Quran to us in the generations unless it's full of the Sufi scholars. You will not find hadith chains unless it's full of the Sufi scholars. You will not find fiqh chains that connect us to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam except it's full of Sufi scholars. So if now some people in this century, in the last 100 years, through their oil money, they spread rumors and propaganda and false information about Sufis and tasawwuf, claiming that they're deviant or misguided or whatever, that doesn't change the facts. We are Muslims, and this is what we should use. We are Muslims and only Muslims. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called us. But when people attack one of our sciences, tasawwuf is one of the sciences of Islam, just like fiqh is one of the sciences of Islam. What is fiqh about? How you pray, how you fast. Tafsir is one of the sciences of Islam. What is tafsir about? How you understand the Quran. Hadith or mustalah, that's one of the sciences of Islam. What is it about? It's about how you understand hadith, how you know this hadith is authentic, this hadith not authentic. Usul or aqidah or ilmul kalam, that is one of the sciences of Islam. What is it about? It's about belief in Allah and the messengers and what are the attributes of Allah, this, etc. Tasawwuf is one of the sciences of Islam. What is it about? How you purify your soul. How you clean your heart of its diseases. How you draw closer to Allah. How you elevate in the ranks. How you draw and come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through ibadah. All of those sciences are under the Quran and the Sunnah. Anything in fiqh, in the science of fiqh, that disagrees with Quran and Sunnah, we throw it away. Anything in tafsir, you see in tafsir books some like stuff that it's absolutely rejected. Anything in science of tafsir that disagrees with Quran and Sunnah, we throw it away. Anything in tasawwuf, same thing. Against Quran and Sunnah, we throw it away. Is it clear? Now, are there people in the science of fiqh who are wrong and who do wrong stuff and who say wrong stuff? Yes. But do we say all faqih and all fuqaha are wrong? No one says this except the insane people. In fiqh, there are some scholars that tell you, come on brother, it's okay to shake hands with ladies, no problem. Any lady, no problem. Young, old, no problem. No problem, nothing wrong. It's fine to have mixing with sisters without limitations, no problem. It's sisters are okay, they can take their hijab here because you know here they're afraid and you know this is non-Muslim country. So there are people in every sciences of Islam, in every science they bring false stuff. But we don't say, because those people, we don't say, fiqh is wrong. Fuqaha are deviant. Those fuqaha are deviant, right? This will be just insanity. Same thing in tasawwuf. Are there people in tasawwuf who belong to tasawwuf, to this science of the sciences of Islam? Are there people who do wrong stuff? Of course, there are people who get like these like swords and they put them in their belly and they claim like this is like ibadah or this is whatever. No, that has no relation to tasawwuf. But we don't generalize over the people who seek and try to elevate themselves and clean their hearts, as the Quran and Sunnah command us. May Allah make us among them. So dhikr, dear brothers and sisters, dhikr is the purpose and the objective of all ibadat, that you reach ihsan. And this is why our Shaykh, the late Grand Mufti of Syria, Shaykh Ahmad Kaftar, may Allah shower him with his mercy, he would say, oh my son, you don't have to use these terms, tasawwuf or sufi, use the word ihsan. Ihsan. And this is what we say, we never use these words, but when people attack these terms and consider us as deviant and consider us sometimes as kafir, don't be surprised. There's someone here in this city, in this county. When he heard about me, he said, I prefer a kafir to teach my kids rather than a Sufi. This is what this person said here, and this person of so-called education. So it's important, dear brothers and sisters, to know these, to know the facts, not to be like deceived by those websites and those people and those YouTubes, etc., etc. So dhikr or tasawwuf is, dhikr is to reach the ihsan position. Ihsan is, as Rasulullah said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to worship Allah as if you see Him. And if you cannot reach that level, then you know that He sees you. That's what it is about. That's what dhikr is about. We'll finish with an amazing hadith from our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Sayyiduna Abdullah bin Busr radiyallahu anhu. He said, a man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, inna shara'i' al-Islam qad kathurat alayhi. The laws and the good deeds and the legislations of Islam have become very, very much for me. I don't know what to do. There are sunnah prayers and nafil prayers and witr and da'wah and fasting, charity, teaching. There are so many things in this religion. So tell me about something. أخبرني بشيء أتشبث به. Tell me of something of all of these things, so that I hold fast to, atashabbath. This verb in Arabic, like you hang with all of your body to the thing. Tell me of something that I should attach myself to and hold fast to. He said, لا يزال لسانك رطبا من ذكر الله تعالى. Let your tongue always be wet with the remembrance of Allah. That's it. Let your tongue always be wet with the remembrance of Allah. That's what we're going to do, inshallah, after Sunnah prayer. Join us, inshallah. May Allah accept. Jazakallah khair.